Good morning, students. Let's go ahead a little more with the word taxonomy. We have already introduced this word. We know what does taxonomy mean. We already know about taxonomy. We know that taxonomy is the science of, if I make it short, it is identification, classification, and nomenclature. Very simple. What is taxonomy? It is a science of, remember, three words: identification, classification, nomenclature. You identify something new. You give it a class, you put it in a specific place, this is classification, and you name it. So what are the three key words associated with taxonomy? It is the science of identification, classification, nomenclature. Am I okay? Please do not change the sequence when you give the definition. Because obviously, nomenclature cannot come before identification. First you will identify something, then you will put it into groups, and then a name will be given to it according to the group it has. So remember, the sequence should not change. Whenever you are defining taxonomy, the sequence of these words should not change. It is identification, class, and nomenclature, classification. So let's do it very fast. What is taxonomy? It is a science of identification, classification, and nomenclature. Now, based on characteristics, all living organisms, you know, are classified into different categories. We have already discussed this earlier also. Based on similarities in characters, difference in characters, different organisms are put into different categories. Now scientists, they give a term for these categories, and these categories are called as taxa. What do you call them as? Taxa in plural, you know that. So what are these categories called? They are called as taxa. Based on certain similarities of characters or dissimilarities of characters, all the organisms are put into specific categories. And these specific categories, the scientific term for these categories is taxa, T-A-X-A. So what is taxa? It is a scientific term for categories. Now, Carolus Linnaeus is considered as the father of taxonomy. So many times you've taken the name of this great person, Carolus Linnaeus. He is also known as the father of taxonomy. Now, what is the basis of modern taxonomy? Now we have taxonomy. What are we doing in taxonomy, children? We are identifying, we are classifying, and we are naming. I told you identification, classification, and nomenclature. So there should be some basis of this process. I'll tell you what are the basis of modern taxonomy. The first is morphology. What is the first one? Morphology means you have to observe and compare the structure of the organism. Observe the structure. Compare it with the structure of different other species or different organisms. This is called morphology. Is it okay? What is morphology? Observation and comparison of structure is what we call as morphology. The second is cytology. What is cytology? Structure of cell. Observation of cells, looking at the cells, how they are different from other organisms. So this study of cells is what we call as cytology. Study of the structure of cells. What is this called? Cytology. The third is embryology. Embryology means the development process. How an embryo is made from the zygote. In different organisms, this process is different, which you learn later when we do reproduction. So, development process is what we call as embryology. And the last one is your ecology. Ecology what? Ecological information of organisms. So, what are the four main bases of modern taxonomy? I'm taking it again with you. There are four bases of modern taxonomy. The first one is morphology, that is observation of structure. The second is cytology, observing the structure of cells. The third is embryology, development process. And the fourth is ecology. That is, what is ecology? It is the ecological information of organism. So four basic pillars of modern taxonomy are morphology, cytology, embryology, ecology. I am very sure you know what are the four basic structures of modern taxonomy. Beta, they are morphology, which means structure. Cytology is structure of cells. Embryology is a development process. And ecology is the ecological history of an organism. So, what are the four basic foundations of modern taxonomy? Morphology, cytology, embryology, and ecology. This branch of classification or taxonomy is not new. Right from many thousand years back, people have been trying to group or classify things. I told you earlier also, they were doing it on the basis of uses. Now, the older system of taxonomy is known as classical taxonomy. Like we have modern taxonomy. The old classification systems were known as what taxonomy? That is known as a classical taxonomy. And you should remember two people contribution, maybe two people who contributed a lot in classical taxonomy. See, when we talk about modern taxonomy, we talk about Linnaeus. I'm very sure you know about this name. But when we talk about the old taxonomy, which is known as classical taxonomy, remember about two main people. The first is Aristotle and the second is Theophrastus. Theo, T-H-E-O, Theo, Phras, P-H-R-A-S, Theophrastus, T-U-S. Now let me do the spelling together. T-H-E-O, Theo, P-H-R-A-S, Phras, T-U-S, Theophrastus. So two main people who are associated with classical taxonomy. When I use the word classical taxonomy, I mean old taxonomy. So two main people who contributed a lot to classical taxonomy, remember these names? They are Aristotle and Theophrastus. Now this concept of classical taxonomy slowly vanished away, it went away with the development of more things coming in. And then we had a new term coming in that is called as the modern taxonomy. What has taken place of classical taxonomy? Earlier we had classical taxonomy, it has been replaced by the modern taxonomy, which is known as modern taxonomy. This word, modern taxonomy, this concept was given by Julian Huxley. Remember the name of this person? Julian. J-U-L-I-A-N, Julian Huxley. H-U-X-L-E-Y, Huxley, 1940. You need not remember the date. I just keep mentioning so that you remember how soon or how late something was done. This was something 1900s. So this is 1940. So I have given you three terms, beta. First is classical taxonomy. The old system of classification, the old system of taxonomy is known as classical taxonomy. Two people associated with classical taxonomy are Aristotle and Theophrastus. Then the concept of modern taxonomy. This was given by Julian Huxley in 1940. Let's talk about the next thing now, taxonomic categories. See, Vina, if you see, classification is not a single step process. It is not that you just do one step and thing is classified. Classification is not a single step process. It involves a series of steps, or you could say a hierarchy of steps. Look at this word, hierarchy of steps. Hierarchy means arranging something in ascending order or descending order. This is hierarchy. Supposing I talk about an institution, I talk about a school. I start with hierarchy, director, principal, vice principal, coordinators, teachers, monitors, students, office, foot staff. What is this? This is all hierarchy. I hope you understood the word. What does hierarchy mean? I can start from the top or I can start from the bottom. So this is hierarchy. So we have a hierarchy of steps. Remember that this taxonomy or classification is not a single step process. It involves a hierarchy of steps in which each step represents a category or a rank. Like I gave you an example now, each step. Talking about each step is what we call as a rank, or it is a category. When I talk about principal, it is a rank. When I talk about a vice principal, it is again a rank. Teachers, it is again a category or a rank. Now see, Peter, since each category is a part of the overall taxonomic arrangement, these all categories go and become a part of taxonomic arrangements. That is why these categories are known as taxonomic categories. What are they called as? Taxonomic categories, because they are categories but they are part of a taxonomic hierarchy. They are part of which hierarchy? Taxonomic hierarchy. That is why we call these categories as what categories? They are known as taxonomic categories or taxonomic hierarchy. They are part of taxonomic hierarchy. So these categories are known as taxonomic categories. Moving on to the next term, that is taxon. Each unit of classification, I mean each rank, is what we call as taxon. Each category, each level, each rank is what we call as a taxon. And the plural is taxa. When I just talk about teachers, it's a taxon. When I talk about teachers, students, monitors, I'm talking about many taxons. So the plural word which I will use is taxa. Singular is taxon, plural is taxa. And what is taxon? It's each category, each rank in a hierarchy is what we call as a taxon. This term taxon, it was introduced by ICBN. I'm sure you all know about ICBN, we've already done it. So it was somewhere in 1956, again to remind you, don't remember the date, there's no need to learn the date. In 1956, it was ICBN which gave this term taxon. So this term taxon was given by ICBN. We had another person, Mayer, M-A-Y-R. What is his name? Mayer, M-A-Y-R. He tried to define taxon. See, what definition did he give for taxon? Taxon is a group of any rank or assigned a definite category. Any rank, any category, which has characters sufficiently distinct to be worthy of being assigned a definite category. He's saying taxon, you can consider any group, any category, which has certain characters which are distinct from the other characters. Let's talk about the category of teachers. Okay, let's talk about which taxon teachers. They all have a similarity. Though they are teaching different subjects, but what is the similarity? They are all teaching. So this is a sufficient similarity. This is a sufficient basis to put them into a separate group or to put them into a separate category. So how did he define taxon? He said taxon is a group of any rank. It could be any rank. We could talk about teachers. We could talk about students. So taxon is a group of any rank. Remember, it has sufficient categories to be worthy of being sufficient similarities. So much so that you can put it in a different category. Simply, if I define taxon, the simple language, if you go and define simple language, taxon, beta, listen, it's a group of similar, related individuals having some characters which are similar but distinct from the other group. It's a group of people, group of organisms which have some characters which are similar to each other but different from the another group. Supposing I have a taxon for teachers and I have a taxon for students. Why do I have a separate category or taxon for teachers? Because we have a similarity. All teachers have a similarity that all teachers teach the students. All the students I have put in a separate taxon or a separate category because all of you have a similarity that all of you are there to study. But why did I not combine the teachers and students and make a single taxon? The reason is very simple, that each taxon has categories which are distinct from the other taxon. However, all the members of one taxon have similarities. So all those members who had similarities, like all those teachers who had the similarity were put in one category, that is teachers. Similarly, all the students had a similarity that they are here to study, they have been put into another category, that is students. So I hope you understood what is a taxon. Taxon is what, beta? In simple language, it is a group of similar related individuals. Individuals which are related to each other on the basis of certain similarities. And they have some characters which are same to each other but different from the other categories or other taxon. Is it okay for everybody? Teachers are one taxon because they have similarities, but they are students are a different taxon. Because teachers have been put in one taxon, they have similarity with each other. But all the teachers, they differ from students in one sense. They don't have similarities. That is why taxon for students has been different. Though teachers and students are not a taxon here in scientific classification, this is just to explain you that group of individuals or organisms which have similarities are put in one taxon. And they must be having some differences from the other. That is why the others have been put in a separate category, that is in a separate taxon. Moving on to the other word, taxonomic hierarchy. It is a system of arranging different categories in an order. Hierarchy, I told you, is an order. If you remember, I told you director, principal, this is the code, this is an order. Taxonomic hierarchy, system of arranging all the taxons or all the categories in a sequence in a proper order is what we call as taxonomic hierarchy. Since it was introduced by Linnaeus, who gave this idea first? It was Linnaeus somewhere in 1751. That is why this system is also known as Linnaean hierarchy. It is known as Linnaean hierarchy because it was Linnaeus who tried to put them in a stepwise order or in a hierarchy. Hierarchy, I told you, ascending to descending, descending to ascending, any order. That is hierarchy. It was Linnaeus who first tried to make this hierarchy and he tried to put all the different categories in a sequence. Okay? And that is why this hierarchy is also known as which hierarchy? It is known as the Linnaean hierarchy. Moving on to the taxonomic categories data. If I talk about the ascending order, let me start from the lowest order. It is the lowest order, the lowest level is species. Then it is genus, family, order, class, division, kingdom. I am talking about plants. Okay, there is only one minor difference between plants and animals. So don't worry, first we'll do about plants. Let me go in descending order. If I go in descending order, it is kingdom, division, class, order, family, genus, species. I need a simple formula on the board. If you can see, KDCOFGS. KDCOFGS. Now you can make any sentence of your own for your self-explanation, for your learning yourself. Like KD, you can say kaisa din. COF, class of. Matlab kuch bhi. You can frame a Hindi sentence. I would like you to do it in the class today. Okay, so that it's become simple for you to learn. Like we learned that periodic table na. अलमारी चांदी से बनी है एंड ऑल दैट. इफ यू रिमेंबर द पीरियोडिक टेबल वी मेक हिंदी सेंटेंसेस. आई वुड सजेस्ट यू मेक हिंदी सेंटेंसेस फ्रॉम दिस इन द क्लास टुडे. जस्ट रिमेंबर द फॉर्मूला. इट इज KDCOFGS. KDCOFGS. KDCOF. KDCOFGS. सो दिस इज सिंपल फॉर प्लांट्स. K स्टैंड्स फॉर किंगडम. D इज योर डिविजन. C इज क्लास. O is order, F is family, G is genus, and S is species. So how did we learn the sequence? Very simply, if we go in descending order, it is KDCOFGS. You know what K means, you know what D means. The only difference here is, in place of division, what we are going to have is phylum. That's all. So the same formula which said KDCOFGS now becomes KPCOFGS. When we talk about animals, the same formula in place of KD, use the word KP, where P stands for phylum. That means for plants we use the word division, but for animals we use the word phylum. So what is the hierarchy? If I go in decreasing order, what is the hierarchy for plants? It is KDCOFGS. KD, kingdom division. COF, class, order, family. GS, that is genus and species. For animals, the same formula becomes KPCOFGS. KP, kingdom, but P stands for phylum here. And C again is the class, order, family, genus and species. There is no difference. I hope the formula is there with everybody. Try to frame the Hindi sentence today in the class itself. We'll see. Let's get the best one. So for plants, the formula is KDCOFGS. For animals, it is KPCOFGS. Now see, moving on to the next one, that is obligate or common characteristics. Okay, what are obligate or common categories? I'll tell you what is obligate category. If you come across the word obligate category or common category, what does it mean? Obligate means what? Obligate word comes from the word obligation. Obligation matlab karna hi karna hai. You have to do this. That is what you call as obligation. So obligate category, category jisko manna hai, karna hi karna hai. That is what we call as obligate category. So what is an obligate category? The taxonomic categories which are always used when you do hierarchy classification of organisms. You have to always use them. Whenever you are classifying, whenever you are following the hierarchy classification, you have to use these categories. That is why these categories are known as obligate categories or they are known as common categories. What are these obligate categories? The same ones which I told you. If you talk about a plant, you have to use, you have to tell me which is the kingdom, which is division, which is class, order, family, genus. So this KDCOFGS, is they are all obligate categories of plants, and KPCOFGS are all obligate categories of animals. Obligate means compulsory. Supposing you discover a new species of plant, you have to put it in a specific kingdom, division, class, order, family, genus, species. You cannot skip any one of them. That is why we call these characteristics or these categories as obligate categories, or we call them as common categories. Now you see beta. All the members of a taxonomic category have some features which are similar but different from the others. Obviously, the maximum similarity you will find in the members of species. Maximum similarity you will find where? In the different members of a species. If I talk about a particular species, like we talk about our species, you will find maximum similarities in human beings, one to other. So maximum similarity is found in species. When you go higher in hierarchy, this similarity between members keeps on decreasing. That means the maximum similarity will be found in different members of a species, and the lowest or the minimum similarity will be found in the members of the kingdom, Plantae Animalia. You know that, okay? Two different kingdoms we have. We'll go to it later. Anyways, maximum similarities you will find in the member of a species, and the lowest similarity you will find in the members of kingdom, highest. What am I trying to say? The lower the level, the more is the similarity. The higher you go in a hierarchy level, the similarities keep on decreasing. Then what is species, beta? Species is very simple. Species is the lowest taxonomic category. You can see on the board, it's the lowest taxonomic category. it is consisting of what? It consists of all the members which resemble one another very closely. The members of this species, they resemble each other very closely. And the most important thing is that each member of a particular species has the potential to interbreed. Interbreed breeding is possible between different members of a species, but they are reproductively isolated from other species. Reproductively isolated from other species means reproduction is not possible. Interbreeding is not possible between members of different species. It is possible between the members of the same species. So how do you define species beta? Three things you need to remember about species. The first is they are the lowest taxonomic category. Second, the members of the same species are quite similar to each other. They can interbreed. And the third most important thing, they are reproductively isolated from other species. I'll give you some scientific names. Let me discuss with you again. Mangifera indica. Look at the second one. That indica is a specific epithet which represents the species. Indica. Solanum tuberosum. This is potato beta. Solanum tuberosum. Solanum S-O-L-A-N-U-M solanum. Tuberosum. Tuber O-S-U-M tuberosum. This is potato. So that second word which I have written, tuberosum, represents your specific epithet. Similarly, Panthera leo. That second word, that is leo, represents the specific epithet. What about the first words? Mangifera, Solanum, Panthera, they represent the next higher level, that is the next category, that is genus. So each genus may even have more than one specific epithets. Each genus may have more than one specific epithets means each genus may have more than one species. Let me explain it to you. We just said Panthera leo. Panthera is a genus, leo is a specific epithet, and you know it is lion. Similarly, we have Panthera tigris, that is tiger. If you see, the genus remains the same, that is Panthera. What is changing is a specific epithet, that is tigris. Panthera pardus, P-A-R-D-U-S, Panthera pardus, this is leopard. So if you see, I have given you three examples of the same genus. We had Panthera leo, that is lion. We had Panthera tigris, that is tiger. We had Panthera pardus, P-A-R-D-U-S, that is leopard. See, Panthera. The first word is same. That means the genus is the same. But what is different is a specific epithet. That means one genus can have more than one specific epithet. I just proved it to you. One more example very interesting I'll give you is about Solanum. I told you about Solanum tuberosum, that is potato. Solanum tuberosum is potato. Similarly, this word Solanum melongena, melongena, M-E-L-O-N-G-E-N-A, melongena, this is brinjal. Isn't it interesting? Potato and brinjal, they have been put in the same genus. They must be obviously having some similar characteristics, otherwise it is no point that we put two different species in a genus. Let me tell you a few of them. See, the first thing is the inflorescence. Inflorescence is same in potato and brinjal. Inflorescence means what, beta? It means the arrangement of flowers in a plant. That is what we call as inflorescence. Similarly, venation. Venation is the arrangement of veins in a leaf. You see those lines on a leaf? They are known as veins. You have different kind of venations, which I will be telling you later when we do some practicals. You must have seen different leaves. Some of them have a mesh of lines. Some of them have broader lines. This is known as venation. Okay? So venation is similar. Inflorescence is similar and phyllotaxy is similar. This is a word P-H-Y-L-L-O, phyllotaxy, T-A-X-Y. Phyllotaxy is arrangement of leaves on the stem, is what we call as phyllotaxy. So brinjal and potato, though externally, they are very different. Okay, we have put them in different species because their interbreeding is not possible. So they are in different species. But they have been put in a different they have been put in the same genus because they resemble each other. I have given you three examples to prove that they resemble each other. The first is phyllotaxy. Phyllotaxy is arrangement of leaves on the stem. Second, I told you about venation, that is about the veins in a leaf. And the third I told you is inflorescence, that is arrangement of flowers in the plant. So they resemble each other. Two examples to prove that each genus may have more species. Panthera leo, Panthera tigris, Panthera pardus. Similarly, Solanum tuberosum and Solanum melongena. What is a genus now? We have already done species. Moving on to the next higher level, that is genus, it's very easy. Genus comprises a group of related species which have more similarities to each other compared to other species. it's exactly the same definition. Like Solanum, I gave you this example, Solanum tuberosum and Solanum melongena. Both of them have been put in the same genus because they had certain similarities, but they're not same species. Why? Because they're not able to interbreed. Similarly, I gave you example of Panthera. Panthera leo, Panthera tigris, Panthera pardus, all of them have been put in the same genus because they have certain similarities, but they have been put in different species because they are not able to interbreed. So we have done the last two species levels, that is species and genus, and the next in higher is family. Just combine the same definition. It is a group of closely related genera with more number of similarities to each other. But remember, the similarities will keep on decreasing as we go higher in the level. Maximum similarities will be in species. There will be a little less when it comes to genus and a little more less when it comes to family. Let's talk about species. When I say Panthera leo, it's a species. All lions are very closely related to each other, very similar to each other. But if I compare two different species, when I move on to genus and I take two different species, I take Panthera leo, I take Panthera tigris, I take Panthera pardus. Lion, tiger, leopard, though all carnivores, they are all different, they have some similarities, but you see the similarities are less compared to what level? Species level. So my conclusion in the video is, the lower the level, the more is the similarity, the higher you go up, the similarity keeps on decreasing.